Okay, welcome everyone to the December 21st Hadley School Committee meeting. And I'll be chairing the meeting tonight as Linda Dunleavy unfortunately is not able to join us tonight. We also have some folks at the table that are new. I'm going to ask you to introduce yourself as student representatives. Let's start with you.
I'm Jenny Moss and I'm a senior here at Hopkins Academy.
Now I'm Bridget Lashway and I'm also a senior at Hopkins Academy.
Great, thank you Jenny. Thank you Bridget. Welcome. Thank you. Okay, calling the meeting to order. First item is to approve the minutes from November 23rd, our last meeting. Any questions about the minutes or changes?
No.
Motion to approve?
Motion to approve.
Second it.
Great. Thank you. Hey, Roby. We just got started. Okay, adjustments to the agenda. We do have a couple. Brian Beck, we're going to be adding two topics, student representatives, and mid-year science teacher middle school appointment. Those are the two adjustments that I have. We also have an adjustment in that we will need to add an action item to our list to vote on the bus bids that we've received. Any other adjustments to the agenda? Okay. Moving on to presentations.
Yes, so in your packet, you received a summary of the Washington, D.C. field trip. Mr. Burns sends his regrets. He's sorry he is not here this evening, although this field trip is a regular occurrence of the October field trip to Washington, D.C. And so in your packet, Mr. Burns explains the itinerary, the kinds of activities the students would be doing, and the field trip request form, a copy that was also in your packet, indicating the start time, end time, and the per student cost, which is $640. And Mr. Burns has indicated that they will be doing as much fundraising as they are able to in order to defray the cost.
Great. Now, Jason's not here, but any discussion on this?
So this is the usual
trip
to Washington.
Yes, it is. That's correct.
In fact, though, I've been speaking with Mr. Burns over the last couple of days. They're planning on following, relatively speaking, almost exactly the same itinerary that they had from last year, which worked this past fall, which students loved, other than the illness that everybody caught on the trip.
Doesn't sound good. How long have they been doing this, Brian? Do you know? It's been a while?
I think there was just 1 year in the time that I've been here that maybe it hasn't run. And I think in prior years they had alternated years. It's the intent, I believe, to cultivate a similar number of students by doing it year by year, as they had a number of students who came back and cultivated interest in other younger students.
And is it open to just a certain class?
It has typically been 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. But he may decide to open it up to ninth graders at some point, depending on numbers.
Currently, his request form lists grades 11 and 12.
Oh,
looking at 45 students. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay, we do need to approve. We can take the action item on this. Any motion to approve the trip to Washington, D.C.?
Motion to approve to Washington, D.C.
Great.
Second.
All right. Great. Okay, the next all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. Yeah. I'll put a check mark by it. Thank you. Okay, the presentation on the HEA support for moratorium on statewide standardized testing. You had an update on that.
Yes, so as I said, Mr. Burns regrets that he cannot be here. He did provide information. He had originally sent this along to me and Linda Dunleavy, and Linda had suggested placing it in the packet as something that the HEA could come and have a conversation with the school committee about this. If the school committee would prefer to have this conversation when there's an HEA rep available, we can do that, or it's entirely up to the school committee.
I would prefer that we probably, well, my opinion is that we have a chance to discuss it when an HEA rep is here, to defer this to January.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would agree.
Okay.
Okay.
So we will push that to January. Okay. And the last presentation, DESE 2015 accountability data.
So this is probably feeling rather old for the school committee since I eagerly did this all by hand over the summer. But why I put it in your packet is because our actual report card was published in December. So the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education did not post accountability report cards. Usually those are posted in August. And this year, because of PARC, they weren't available until December. So we remain a level two because one or more of our schools are at level two. And you can see in the chart that's in there, the only thing that changed from my calculation was on the Hopkins Academy high needs, they because they changed who qualifies in the low income category of the high needs group, the department decided that if any school district declined in annual PPI for that subgroup, that they would just hold them to the level of the previous year. So that was the only thing that's different from the calculations you got over the summer. If you look under the cumulative PPI, each one of those groups needs to be at 75 in each of the buildings in order for the school to be eligible for level one, and the district is assigned the level of its lowest performing school. The good news is, which I pointed out before, but I'll restate for the public, we are particularly pleased with some of the gains that we made. If you see the annual PPI in 2014 at Hadley Elementary School, all students went from 45 in 2014 to 75 in 2015. High need students went from 31 PPI, their points out of 100, to 81 in 2015. We saw gains district all around, a 10-point gain. We saw a slight decline in PPI at Hopkins, and I know that the Hopkins faculty has been looking very closely at that and at what might have contributed to that and what they can do to change that. And you also see that our growth below the growth chart is something new. So this is our student growth percentile for the entire group in the aggregate. And for the most part, moderate growth is between 40 and 59. Anything 60 or above is considered high growth. 80 and above is considered very high growth. So you can see that for the most part, we're in moderate growth in 2015. The exception being the high needs subgroup at Hopkins and students with disabilities district-wide is just shy of moderate growth, but in what is considered low growth. And so are there any questions about the accountability data? You've seen this. You're just happy that it's finally over. The official ones are out. I can't put it in the packet again. I have to leave it alone until August. No more MCAS accountability data.
Okay, and added the presentation to the agenda, Mr. Beck, on student representatives and the mid-year science teacher.
Sure. for the science position, we're sad to learn that Natalie Savoy, our 8th grade science and health teacher, has taken a position in her home school district, her alma mater. She's effectively going home, and while we're very happy for her, we're obviously sad for our students. And the position has been posted. myself, Science Department Chair Kathy Nagella, and middle school team leader Susan Duncan will review applications and begin interviewing, hopefully immediately after the vacation, to fill that vacancy. If there is any lag time between the appointment of a new teacher and Ms. Savoy's departure, we've secured Diane Chapman, who had been in the position prior, who can get us through up until such time as we have a full-time teacher on staff. So
why is it okay time to go looking for someone instead of looking for a long-term substitute? You're looking for a permanent teacher in January?
Yeah, I think it makes sense to post for the position because there's certainly there's a great chance that we could find licensed applicants out there, and if we don't, then the contingency plan would be to go with a long-term substitute if we didn't find anybody who was licensed.
And may I add, we already the day that we had the posting up received applications from licensed and experienced applicants.
And did you?
So thank goodness that there are districts that people are eager to leave and come join us.
And I'm very pleased that Bridget and Jenny have agreed to represent the student body as school committee representatives, as interim school committee representatives. I've asked the student council, who developed a constitution last year, to create an amendment to their constitution to create a structure to vote for two school committee representatives, and two rather than one, simply because there's often conflicts for highly involved students, and we'd like to always have the opportunity for at least one of them to be here. We recognized last year that Ali Huntoon, who did a great job, was only able to make about 50% of the meetings last year. So having two hopefully guarantees us the opportunity to have a student voice here sitting with the committee. Okay. We anticipate that the student council will get together the Thursday after the vacation to take up the issue and hopefully add an amendment to their constitution, which would clarify a protocol for voting and whether it would be the student council who would vote what graduating class students need to be in and so forth. I trust that they'll put that all together, and it's best to have students lead that. But in the meantime, I felt comfortable selecting two students as interims.
Thank you.
Welcome.
So this is the first that since I've been here that we've had student liaisons. I love it. So what's the role?
Well, it provides it's a role that's somewhat at this particular point in time undefined. I know that last year we wanted to be able to have a student representative on the committee to be able to provide you guys at least the opportunity that when there were things going on at Hopkins or even to talk about their experience vertically in through the school district. I know there were a number of questions that could be asked from time to time, and it was difficult for the committee to at least get some gauge without a student actually being present. And so we hope that the position can evolve as an elected position. We went through, Dr. McKenzie and I sat through one presentation in April Camuso's class where a number of students did really fantastic presentations on making improvements to the school environment in general, what they wanted to see improve in education overall. And they made some recommendations directly to Hopkins, directly in regard to Hopkins, and this was one of the recommendations that they made. So I think that students have some ideas on how the position might be able to evolve and what role they might play. So rather than us, sort of configuring that role, I think it's good to steal ideas from the kids and allow them to take that lead and that responsibility.
That's great.
And they, as I told Bridget and Jenny this evening, they simply have the agenda. What they would receive before every school committee meeting is the entire packet. That would also give them a chance to identify any topics on there that the school committee might very much want a student perspective or student feedback on. And as Mr. Beck said, you can always ask. You all don't have to have the answer to everything, by the way, so don't be worried about that. You can simply say, we can go back to the student body and find the answer to that. You don't have to speak on behalf of the student body if you're not prepared to do so. But if you ever saw anything in the agenda, you could check in with students about it, and you can also come right over and see me and say, you know, you might want to think about this before presenting that.
That's good.
Great. Well, we're happy to have you here. Okay, that's the last of the presentations. We move now into the public comment period. I just want to remind folks that since we do have public comment, we do have public here to participate, that we do have a policy that, has this been handed out?
There are some copies over there, but if you wanted to read it.
In case folks aren't aware, we do have a policy about public participation at school committee meetings. It is policy BEDH out of all of the policy committees' policies. It's posted online, and it is public, and it essentially lays out the rules according to how we interact or not necessarily interact during public comment. So I'm just going to go through them really quick, 1 through 6, and then we'll open it up. I'm not sure if there are multiple public comments here, but we'll need to go in some semblance of an order. So the first one, at the start of each school committee meeting, individuals or group representatives will be invited to address the school committee during a public comment period. The length of the public comment period shall be determined by the chairperson. Speakers will be allowed 3 minutes to present their material. The presiding chairperson may permit extension of this time limit with the school committee approval. The public comment period will be recorded as part of the regular meeting. Number 3, members of the school committee will generally not respond to speakers during the public comment period. Number four, the chairperson has the right to allow audience members to ask clarifying questions during school committee discussion of agenda items. Number five, improper conduct and remarks will not be allowed. Defamatory or abusive remarks are always out of order. If a speaker persists in an improper conduct or remarks, the chairperson may terminate that individual's privilege of address. And number six, all remarks will be addressed through the chairperson of the meeting. So with that framing, we obviously always welcome public comment, and I'm glad to see we have some here. So I'll open up public comment. Who will go first?
I'd be happy to kick off. I'm a paraprofessional at Hadley Elementary, and as are these lovely people who are with me. And we are not all going to make public comments. We've rounded it up to a public comment that I will read. Okay? When I tell people I work at Hadley Elementary, I always get the same response. Oh, I hear that's a good school system. I agree with them. And I believe that the education support professionals of Hadley, the paraprofessionals, are an essential part of that good education. Massachusetts is considered to be the most educated state in the Union, a state that values education and delivers quality to its students. Even on the international PISA test of 15-year-olds, Massachusetts ranked in the top 10 in the world. So Hadley is a good school in a great state, and we are part of that success. We believe that the Hadley community and school administration value a good education. We know that to be true because when they hire new paraprofessionals, they always choose the most experienced and academically best qualified candidates they can find. Among your paraprofessionals, you will find that a bachelor's degree is standard and a teaching license or advanced degree is not unusual. If you believe in quality education, you know that that quality comes through in our work. If it didn't, why attain a good education? All the students of Hadley benefit from our education and experience, whether they're receiving one-on-one support as per their IEP, or direct instruction in small groups, or education from class-specific aides who deliver, along with the teacher, the curriculum that we know works in Massachusetts. If your child never receives support directly from paraprofessionals, he is an unusual child in this system. At the very least, he benefits from our work with needier students, freeing the teachers to deliver curriculum to the majority of the class. We are asking for fair pay for our work. Currently, some of us are paid more, some less, with no apparent system to determine who is paid what. There are paraprofessionals in this system paid $14.73 an hour who have been here for years and years. Sometimes they have to cover for teachers all day, becoming the teacher, even supervising a substitute teacher, with no extra pay for all that work, responsibility, extra time spent, and experience. There are paraprofessionals paid $16.84 per hour who've only been in the school district for a couple of years, are far less experienced, and have fewer academic qualifications. This is not equitable. We ask that our pay be aligned fairly to reflect years of service and qualifications, and that the base pay of every educational support professional be raised to reflect the work we really do every day in our schools. We are smart people, and it impacts every interaction we have with the Hadley students and improves every task we are asked to complete. People move to this area because of the quality of life it affords. They choose Hadley because of the great schools it offers. We never have a shortage of school choice applicants when we open a grade. We have schools we can be proud of, students, teachers, paraprofessionals, and administrators we can be proud of, but we have a pay scale that does not reflect that pride and achievement. And we thank you for your time and your attention.
Thank you.
May I? Do you have a copy of that, Lisa, that I could add to the packet, please?
Thank you.
I'll write everything down. Thank you so much.
Are there others who wish to speak on this same topic?
Sure. I'm a parent and a teacher at Hadley Elementary School. Everybody here knows that already. But I will say this as a parent, and I'm only speaking as a parent. I've had children that have come through the school system and have needed support along the way through the paraprofessionals or ESP, whatever you're going to be referred to as. And I will say that I do know that everybody that, you know, at least anybody that I've ever encountered has done a phenomenal job, really cares about the students, and really is, you know, just a joy as a parent to, like, have interact with your child. I feel very fortunate that when my children needed support when they were younger, that they were given it. And I just like to say that, you know, just as a parent, I know that I wear a lot of different hats. And, you know, as a teacher, I would say the same. But, you know, speaking from a parent point of view, I know that everybody really gives 110%. And I think that's so important. And I think to value the place that you work and to have parents really appreciate it is really, really important. But I think it's also important for, you know, the school committee to really appreciate what we do have. I think it is a collaborative effort. I think we are very fortunate to have great administrators. I think we're very fortunate to have a school committee that cares. And I do think we are fortunate to have parents who care and paras that care. So I think it's really, I mean, my mantra has always been that it's really a collaborative effort. And I do think that it is a, you know, it is a collaborative effort. And for what it's worth, I think they've always done a really great job.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there any other folks who'd like to speak on this topic? I'll just add, I mean, as a personal note, as a parent, I also have nothing but the best to say about the paraprofessionals that my son has had the privilege of being able to work with. I know that later on in the meeting we'll talk about the Unit D update, which this is in relation to, and we are in the midst of this discussion, essentially trying to arrive at a compensation package that not only we can agree upon, but that the district can financially afford to take on for the 3 years that we're looking at and beyond for hiring. So I am glad that you've all come out and spoken with us as eloquently as you have. I know that we look forward to hearing back from you as part of our negotiations that we're in right now and to continue our meetings that are scheduled in January. Is there anything anybody would like to add?
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. And public... Roby?
So are we having an executive session tonight?
No. The update is general update, not specific. So.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. That's what I get for being late.
You missed exec session. Okay, still in public comment. Are there any other public comments for tonight? Okay. Great. I thank you all for coming out and saying what you said. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay, moving to number 6, District Strategy Progress Report.
So in your packet last time, I didn't include a copy of the district strategy document. I did this time because I was referring to it. So there's a quick update behind it. Most of the work that we focused on has been around the goal of instructional leadership and working on curriculum, ensuring that the curriculum is aligned, instruction is effective, and that meaningful assessments improve teaching and foster deep learning. So we have communicated information from the department that I also passed along to the school committee about the changes to the PARC test administration, specifically in terms of the long composition in March. It's not PARC, I have to remember this. We are doing MCAS. MCAS will change slightly in 2016, this upcoming spring. One of those changes is they are eliminating the long comp. And we pass that information along to our educators and also let them know that there would be additional PARC items that would be included, some PARC items included on the MCAS. So I know that at Hadley Elementary, the faculty has been looking at PARC items and writing prompts to ensure that students are being prepared for these additional questions. Again, we are not administering PARC, but there would be some PARC-like items on the MCAS test. And I'm pleased also to report that the K-2 faculty has really begun an in-depth analysis of how to effectively teach writing at the lower grades so students are well prepared as they progress through Hadley Elementary and Hawkins Academy. At Hadley Elementary, teachers are getting ready in K-3, where we've done response to intervention this year, tiered instructions. They're getting ready to do their next round of assessments. I have seen some progress monitoring data at Hadley Elementary already. So our next big round of kind of check-in assessments will occur in January. But the progress monitoring data I've seen has demonstrated that students are improving. So I'm really pleased that this is effective. We're seeing good results in a short amount of time. And I would like to give a lot of credit to the special education staff. They have started, they have identified their interest, which is to look at how to effectively teach reading, how to diagnose reading difficulties, and ensure that instructional interventions are well matched to the needs that students present when they are struggling readers. We have one of our professionals, and I believe it's a speech-language pathologist, who has an in-depth knowledge of diagnosing reading problems and helping students who exhibit these kinds of problems. And she has indicated that she's willing to lead some professional learning and an inquiry group with teachers to look deeply at how they can better serve struggling readers. So I'm very grateful to Ms. Bell's leadership in this. I'm grateful to the Special Education Department for their willingness to tackle the problem. And with family and community engagement, Hopkins has opened the online gradebook for parents and addressed questions and concerns that they've come in. And another thing, Ms. Bell has facilitated collaboration among parents of students receiving Title I, so those would be federal funds we use for students who appear to be struggling in reading or math, and Title III, which is our ELL, English Language Learners. And she's bringing both groups of parents together for a literacy event March 2nd. And that's your update for this month.
I have a question for you.
Sure.
And maybe this is on the bullet about K-2 faculty mm-hmm. beginning the writing instruction. In mm-hmm. one of our prior meetings, we had a discussion about the use of technology and mm-hmm. how looking ahead to writing, you know, teaching young children keyboarding skills and getting used to the technology. Will that be part of this literacy and, or I'm sorry, writing instruction?
So I believe, I'm going to let you answer that, but I'm gonna queue up a request of yours. I know that the town, this is completely connected but slightly separate. The town gave us budget direction and requested that we create a level service budget. I am fully anticipating that the request that I'm going to get from Mr. Udall at the elementary school will reflect the fact that we need resources to teach students keyboarding. How was that for queuing it up, going to bat?
Yes.
Did I do a good enough job? Yeah, it's coming.
Yes, very good.
So, and then, I'm sorry, speak
so,
to
no,
you,
that's
but
too.
Your faculty is
discussed. So, a couple of the initiatives that we've been doing is the Handwriting Without Tears, which is something that we've implemented K-2. It's to help children just with the mechanics of writing. We found that when I first got here and looked at our writing, we were concerned about their ability to write, from being able to hold the pencil or pen or crayon or whatever, up to being able to expressively write. And so we started looking at what we were doing. We have a writing committee that we review writing samples. We've done school-wide writing prompts over the last few years. We've used the scoring rubrics that have either been in the upper grades that are MCAS connected or the Reading Street rubrics that we've been using for the lower grades. So we have an opportunity to see the progress. We provide writing samples from beginning to the end of the year. One of the things that we do at the end of the year is we have students write a letter to their next year's teacher or about a topic by the end of the year, so that next year's teacher will be able to see where their writing levels are. Regarding the keyboarding skills, that has been something that has been a hot topic and discussion. And currently we have Maureen Tumenis, who we have for a 0.5 position, and she's done phenomenal things. I think everybody in our building, you know, just has high praise for her, what she's done to help with the integration of technology, not only with the students, but also with the staff and trainings, and the number of resources that she goes out and finds and shares and has done has been highly commendable. When you look at what we are required to do in following the curriculum, English language arts, the music, I mean, the whole nine yards, it's really difficult for a classroom teacher to also factor in time in a very, very tight schedule to teach them keyboarding skills. And so there's been discussion, because as we get to 2019, when the MCAS 0.20 2.0 will be an electronic test.
It might be 0.2. I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah. That's true.
Yeah.
If we were to have to take it electronically this spring, we'd be in trouble. I mean, because the test is going to be a time test from everything we understand. And hunting and pecking, it's just really difficult. And the teachers don't have the time in their regular schedule right now to dedicate towards keyboarding skills. So what I am going to be presenting to Dr. McKenzie is to increase Maureen's position to a full-time position. She not only would be able to do this, but we'd also be able to schedule times that are regularly scheduled once or twice a week as computer lab time, and where she would do this instructional piece, as well as other things. A 40 or 45 minute lab would involve probably 15 minutes of practicing keyboarding skills, and this would be a continuum that would start second grade, probably maybe third grade. I don't know exactly what she might recommend on up. Definitely probably second grade, because they're going to have to start taking and using those skills for the MCAS in third grade. So those are things that we've had a lot of discussion about, and that's, you know, in part of my my request and the rationale behind it. I don't know if anybody has any questions beyond that.
So that's going to be a forthcoming request.
I'm sorry?
That's going to be a forthcoming request?
Yes, in this year's budget. Budget request for next year.
Yep. Is there a question?
No. Well, I was going to make a comment, actually, if I could. And I don't know how many people do or do not realize this, but we used to have a full-time technology teacher, which, as Mr. Udell stated, Maureen Tumenis is basically half-time, right? And so we did used to have a full-time person at the elementary school years ago. So I don't know, it's just something, it's not here or there, but maybe just putting it out there for everybody to sort of realize that it is something that we did have. And obviously for all of the reasons that Mr. Udall stated, it, you know, it's obviously a good thing, but it is something that we did used to have as well. So to get it reinstated would be wonderful.
Hey, Mary, can you remind me, was that addressed in the technology plan that mm-hmm. you headed up?
Having Maureen go to 100% was addressed as a means to enabling general technology proficiency, but at the time, we hadn't considered that PARC was going to require keyboarding skills in a timed way. So this just fits really nicely with what the district needs anyways.
Right.
Great. Thank you. Okay. Sorry to sidetrack. Personnel report, number 7.
So we've spoken about the middle school science position, we spoke last time about posting positions. So you notice that Ms. Kelly sadly will be leaving us at the end of this year. We have also posted that position as the school committee recommended last time we were together.
Great. Those are posted. Okay.
All right. I'm sorry to see Mr. Skelly go.
Yes.
As am I. And I do want to say I'm also very sad to see Ms. Savoy go. I share Ms. Beck's. I hold her in high regard. She's going back to Westside, where I was her principal when she was in school.
Out.
Yeah, just a little. Just a little.
Okay, Chris, you're up.
Okay, so we have a couple of items in your packages. The first is a much shorter version of the expense report than we had last month.
Thank you.
This is back
slightly
to the
condensed.
What's that?
The condensed version.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's back to the more consolidated version that we typically present to you. Again, really not a heck of a lot to point out. The transfers that I had discussed at the last meeting, moving some of the items to grants, that's been taken care of this past month. Some of the accounts had gone into the negative. We made transfers from other accounts to bring them back up to either a zero balance or a positive balance. I just noticed there's a couple more that have happened since those transfers. So we'll keep on them as the year goes on. Typically, we have transfers within the same category that do not require school committee approval. If we get to the point where we are out of similar accounts that we can't move them out of, I will bring them to you for your approval. But I don't know if anyone has any questions on the expense report at all.
No.
Okay. We have revolving accounts on the agenda. Unfortunately, Heather was in the office actually when I was discussing this to someone there. I have not gotten a response back from the town accountant after numerous requests for the revolving account balances. What I have asked from him is to give me all of the transactions for FYs 15 and 16, hoping that we can just rebuild them in our own system. They have not been in there, but I think it's better if we have them in our system as well, just so we don't have to rely on the town hall to give us the balances. I emailed again today and asked for them and the other items I'm waiting for, and asked that he confirm receipt of the email. I have not gotten a response from that either, so it's been a little bit of a challenge lately with that, but we'll keep trying to correct that situation. I also have the grant report. Again, basically the expenses are moving according to plan. You can see what we've been awarded, what we've used, and the amounts remaining. Only one of the grants at this point in time is fully expended. That's the $3,500 Early Childhood Special Education grant. So the rest of them still have significant funds left to be used, which is always nice. We will spend down the grants before we move to the regular budget. As we found last year, that's certainly the strategy to go when they cut the kindergarten grant mid-year. And fortunately, we had already spent more than the cutoff points we were allowed to keep the funds. It's kind of a good strategic move, really, to use the grants earlier. So we're still moving in that direction. Any questions on the grant report at all? Okay, just a couple of items also to bring to your attention. The first is that we've received back the signed generator contracts. I have requested a timeline from the vendor, so haven't received it yet. I just requested that today. I got the contracts this morning. So when I get that, I will forward that on to you just so you're all aware of how the process will proceed. The second item is I am looking at locking in electricity rates. Our current contract ends in October of 2016. The general opinion is that we should be able to see what might be around a 20% reduction in the rate. So that would be certainly nice to see. And Paul Schroeder at the Collaborative is working on that right now for us. He's had our stuff for about 3 weeks. So we should be hearing something soon. And we can sign now to lock in once the current contract expires.
Chris, is that solar? Or is the solar stuff?
We also have the solar farm where we receive a reduced rate on the electricity. That's not the only charge that we have on the bill, so there are other charges as well. And the rate that we're looking for would be reflected in those charges that we get from the electric company. We do get a separate bill for the electricity we receive from the solar farm. And the last item is we are also looking to lock in an oil price. I would think early in 2016, the prices are fantastic right now, and we can lock them in the first week of January, so I'll be looking at that. What I would typically do is the prices come out daily. I keep watching until they start to turn, and that's when we quickly lock it in. But based on the price I paid when I filled my tanks last week, we should be able to get much better pricing, because I don't typically buy 100,000 gallons on a fill-up. Should be able to see a significant savings from last year's rate. So last year was $2 a gallon. I'm guessing $1.50 or $1.60 this year. So that's pretty good.
Chris, do you need our approval to lock those in? Or
We don't, no.
Okay,
nope.
Great.
And it's nice, really, because that allows us to turn it around very quickly and jump on a price when we can.
Great.
Do we also use the Collaborative for
oil? We do,
oils?
Yes. Yeah. Paul is the man. We rely on Paul basically for all of the energy pricing that we receive.
Do we want to jump ahead to the two action items? I think, are both of these yours, the stipend for mentoring, FY15 expense, and the bus bids?
The stipend. Sorry, I forgot about the stipend for mentoring. Yes, we have a couple of mentors that did not receive pay. They did not submit their schedules and all of their paperwork. last year, so they were not paid for their mentoring last year. It was the two nurse mentors for the new nurse that we had at the elementary school. So we got all the paperwork now. We are looking to pay for that. Unfortunately, I don't remember the amount, and I apologize for that. Do you happen to know?
I don't have it off the top of my head. I don't have a copy of the contract with me either, so I can't say it off the top of my head. So we can wait till to go to
January. If we could, yeah, I apologize for that, actually. I forgot to check it. I'm thinking it's around $3,000, but I can't be sure. So, and obviously, I'd want to give you the correct amount, so.
Okay, we'll shift that to January. And the bus bids?
Yes, we did get the bids on the, I guess they call it a mid-bus. And we received four bids. We received one that was the lowest price. The situation with that bid was we requested a bid for a 2016 bus. This particular vendor bid on a 2016 bus placed on a 2015 chassis. And it's always a wrench thrown in the works with these. And so basically what we need to do at this point is determine whether we want to accept their bid or reject it as not adhering to the specifications that we sent out to everyone.
30, if I could just add to that, because 30B, because this was a bid, not a proposal, not a request for a response, because it was a bid, we're required to award to the lowest responsive and responsible bidder. So if we deem that a bidder is responsive and responsible, they met all bid specs, we're required to go with the lowest. So the first question is, does this meet bid specs? And I believe, I mean, Chris can speak to our recommendation on that. We don't think it does. We think that
no.
When we requested a request for a 2016 bus, mm-hmm. we want all parts to be 2016. And then that would be the first step, is if this bid is in the running and it's deemed responsive and responsible by the committee, the lowest bidder gets the award.
Right.
Basically, we did.
To the other bids if it's not the same spec.
Correct. So that would be what we would, that I think is
saying it doesn't meet the requirements.
Well,
so
you can't judge against the other ones who are in 2016. You can't
right.
The price difference was.
I did speak with Fred on it, and Fred told us that he could certainly defend our not accepting the bid. As he said, it's kind of common sense that if you ask for a 2016 bus, the whole bus would be 2016. The vendor said that they go by the body only, and so therefore he feels it's a 2016 bus. I did tell him not to bid that way, and it's really
is there a significant difference between that bid and the Phoenix side?
The price, I have it here, for the 2015 chassis is $52,178, and the price for the 2016 is $54,393, so about $2,200, roughly.
Thoughts?
I think it's unfair to the others if they put forward a fully 16 bid to go with something that isn't.
Yeah. I'd be worried that you could have a complaint.
We may anyway, quite honestly. We had several emails to me today and mentioned that, but Fred felt comfortable. First, I called the Inspector General's office. They do not handle the complaints anymore. They used to have hearings. They don't do that anymore. But they suggested I speak with Fred, so then I called Fred, and he said basically what I told you, that he could defend that. So I would anticipate when I let him know the decision, if it's not to accept his bid, I could probably file something. I'm not really sure of the process, to be honest, but at that point we would refer it to Fred.
I imagine there's not specific rules.
Well, as I said to the Inspector General's office, the person I spoke with, I said, my God, if you're not an attorney, when you do this, how on earth can you actually make sure that, that all this is covered? Especially when I told him everyone has to bid on the same specifications, and
right.
He went ahead and bid on that anyway. So His reason was that he wanted to meet the deadline, and that was the only way he could meet the delivery deadline. Unfortunately, the delivery deadline was March 1st, and his was March 15th. So, you know, everyone actually didn't meet the delivery deadline. There wasn't a single bidder. But the specs did call that if you could not meet the delivery deadline, you'd have to submit an alternate date, and so everyone did that.
So you need a motion from us to decide what we're doing with this bid? Is that what you need, whether or not it meets the requirements?
Yeah, we would need to have your vote on whether to accept their bid or reject it based on the fact that they did not adhere to the specs.
And did the other bids specify that the full bus and chassis and all are 2016 parts, or did they just fail to specify?
They just listed it as a 2000, this is the second lowest bid. It's a 2016 Micro Bird Chevrolet. It doesn't say, it doesn't specify either way, quite honestly. As Fred said, one would assume. I could certainly, clarify that with them. That's something that none of the others specified a different chassis. This particular vendor said in his letter that it was for a 2015 Chevrolet chassis per the bid specs, except the bid specs did not call for the 2015. It just it met the size requirements.
So I guess the bid specs said what? If the other ones didn't specify the parts, how do you know that the other ones don't have the same situation that the low bidder has?
I would have to go to the second low bidder and clarify with them that they were actually giving us a 2016 complete bus. Yes. But we would certainly need to get it nailed down with the low bidder first on whether we wanted to accept their bid.
Do you need a motion?
I think we need a motion.
Motion to reject the 2016 bus with the 2015 chassis.
That's not meeting the requirements.
That's not meeting the requirements of the bid specs. Can we also go so far as to move to accept the lowest 2016 bid upon clarification that it's entirely a 2016 bus?
I would think that would be a great way to handle it, sure. Yeah.
Okay, so it gives you, just to be clear, it gives you permission, Chris, if you find out there isn't something just about bus particulars that I'm not familiar with. That so if it is a full 2016 bus, go ahead with that.
That's right.
Yeah. That makes sense.
That would be correct, yes.
Yeah. Great. We have a motion.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Aye. Motion approved. Thank you.
And may I say something rather positive before we move on to our school committee updates? So I want to thank Chris. We were notified today that the school district did, in fact, we were awarded the Meritorious Budget Award for FY16. And so
congratulations.
And that is a really big feat. There were only two other districts that received it last year, Springfield and Worcester. So we're really pleased about that. We did get comments and things that we'll have to adjust, but we just adjusted in years going forward their recommendations. So I'm really happy about that. And I also want to, since we have at least one writer here, Bridget, I can't remember, I was thumbing through this today. Did you contribute any articles? Okay,
no,
Ginny did. Excellent, you have a copy of the Hawk's Claw. Fantastic. So well done to all of the writers of the Hawk's Claw and Jenny and Richard articles. Very good. Thank you.
Great. Look forward to reading that. Okay, school committee reports. I will start. You've mentioned Unit D negotiations. We are in the midst of the compensation discussions. We have at least two more meetings scheduled in January, I believe. And with the goal of, this is obviously we're talking about the 15-16 contract year being part of this, so anything that is determined and settled upon will be retroactive. We have talked about that. Secondly, parent and community survey. So my goal is we got to get this started back up in the spring. So it's here again. January, for our January meeting, I'd like to bring back our kind of like a first read of the last survey, just to see if there's any questions that need to be tweaked or adjusted in any way. And in the January meeting, I'd also like to call for any parent volunteers that could help out as we had last year. And typically that role has been in terms of not only reviewing questions for clarity, but also helping with the results and analysis on the back end. So don't be scared, it's pretty easy, and it's actually kind of neat what to do.
Heather, one thing I remember from the last time was that it was a really long survey. We had a lot of people who stopped taking it somewhere before the end. Before we get started, should we do a review of pruning?
Yeah, I think we could look at culling it down. If there are things, I mean, that maybe need to be part of our review, because right. I think that each question was insightful, but if there are things that we feel like we don't need all of these questions in this area, we could prune it back.
And now with our pared down district strategy, we could align more carefully.
That's true, focus on more.
Yeah.
Also, I know that Ms. Bell will have some very specific questions that we will, thank you everyone, some very
thank
specific
you.
Questions that we will need to include in the survey. That's what we got back on our coordinated program review. We have to ask parents about the extent to which their children have access to extracurricular activities and other things. So there are items that Ms. Bell will need in the survey as well.
Okay. Good. So that'll be fun in January. Bring that back around. Okay, building and grounds.
So I don't have much new to report. I think I've had some conversations with some folks to keep things moving. Where we stand is where we stood last meeting, and really think with the new year we need to rejuvenate. And what we're trying to do is parse out the work that is has been planned for the fields here at Hopkins into particular phases, that more manageable phases, and see what's to be prioritized, who can do what, get more cost estimates so we can break down what's over $1 million estimate into more manageable pieces. So coming January, that's we'll look to get that moving forward. And I think at some point, hopefully in the spring, if in the summer, if we start moving forward with those ideas, that we also look to some community volunteers for some of the additional work.
Great. And do you have, just because I can't remember, how many members of the community do you have meeting with you guys?
There is no, there is no ad hoc committee anymore. That was a design committee, so there's not a standard committee with community members on it.
Okay.
So we've had people attend our meeting once. We had a couple people come to a subcommittee meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no committee. There's a little bit of a misunderstanding. That committee dissolved.
So in getting volunteers to help you, what's the forum for being able to do that? What's your source of outreach? Like thinking about methods.
So we had some next steps from that meeting that Roby mentioned, and I think it's really executing those to break it up. And I think Roby and I need to talk, but maybe one of the things we'll do is call another meeting for January and see if we can get some more folks in the community engaged. And then I think really the strategy hasn't changed. It's just implementing that. And it also, the hard part is it entails folks with other expertise that we have to come in and help us understand what the costs are going to be.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's all about getting updated cost figures at this point before we could really move forward with anything involving.
You're not an expert on grading land and fill and soil.
And bus specifications.
And bus chassis.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. Well, thank you. Roby, the
collaborative. The executive director of the collaborative and the North Hampton superintendent wrote a letter to the editor about charter schools and their impact, disproportionate impact on Western Massachusetts public schools. This is something I've brought up before because the collaborative board has discussed it, and it's really an excellent summary of our discussions. The other item from the collaborative is that last month I presented you with a summary of our audit, and then the next week the administrative assistant over there sent the full audit, and it's a requirement by law that is distributed to all of you. And
oh, I'm sorry, you sent it to me?
Office.
And I didn't, yes, and I did not put it in the packet, so
it's available.
It is available in the office. I can include it. Actually, I can send it electronically and then make sure it's also posted on our website since you'll get it electronically. Since the summary, we voted to accept or you reported
on the report? No, I just report back to the committee.
So do we need to vote on the acceptance? That's not our job.
No.
Okay.
No,
all right.
We did that. But the new charter school regulations, the new collaborative regulations have a lot of new requirements for information being distributed back to the school committees as a whole.
Right. Okay. So I will make sure you all get an electronic copy of what Roby sent to me, and there'll be a copy. There is a copy available currently in the superintendent's office for anyone who would like to review the financial audit of the Collaborative for Educational Services.
Okay. That rounds out our school committee
and
reports.
And if I could just say something in general to the letter. I want to say I did send to the school committee members. I received this letter. You'll notice several superintendents had signed it. I received it. I sent it out and then said it's always a challenge to try to get information and make sure we're always adhering with open meeting laws. So I said individually tell me what you think, and then thankfully I appreciate the fact that Roby said, I don't think you can do that. So I said, okay, don't talk to me. And just hold on to it. So I want you folks to understand the reason you don't see my signature on here is because if I sign something as a superintendent of schools, I think it implies to the community that I'm somehow representing the entire district. And so if I'm going to sign something as an individual, it would just say Annie McKenzie. Gal from down the road. And if I'm going to sign a superintendent of schools, I want to make sure it's something that the school committee has said, yes, we want you to endorse this, or we want you to sign it on our behalf. I just want to be careful when I'm doing that. And so it was the timing that caused me to say, this should be a discussion that we have. I will say that since then, the superintendents of the collaborative, the member superintendents have met, because since that, you see, I also gave you a copy of another article that then charter school leaders, a parent of a child in a charter school and the executive director of the Mass Charter Public Schools Association sent letters to the editor. And there's been some discussion among the superintendents that we really want to make sure that this isn't a conversation, it isn't some sort of argument that anyone's having about the value of charter schools. We don't want to get into some sort of argument or fight with charter schools. I'll speak for this community. We have a charter school in our community. I'm very grateful for that charter school. I think they do wonderful work, and I'm glad that they're here. It's really a desire for the legislature to look at, and this is something that we believe is going to be on the ballot as a public ballot initiative around caps on charter schools, whether there should be caps or should not be caps in charter schools. So it's my understanding that may be a ballot initiative, and I'm not sure when they anticipate that. Roby, I don't know if you know when they anticipate it would be a ballot initiative. I don't recall. Next fall, you think? I think it's important that the legislature take a look at the coherence or incoherence of their policy strategies. So during the time that the number of charter schools have increased, we've also had expectations from a Republican governor and a Democratic governor, from two administrations in the state, saying you really might want to look at how to increase efficiency through regionalization. So on the one hand, we're being told that small schools are financially untenable, that they don't make any sense, and they can't possibly do the work that they're charged with. I don't even call them charter schools. They're in fact charter districts. They have a superintendent, they have a board. So simultaneously, while it's being recommended that the current service delivery model in small rural public schools is financially untenable, the legislature is opening up single school districts. I am not saying they should not open up single school districts. I personally, now I'm speaking, I would say, could we just have a coherent message? Are single school districts a possibility or not? Do they make sense or don't they? And that's something I would like greater clarity around.
I think also there are legitimately concerns about the funding mechanism for charter schools and its effect on public education. As there's a discussion about funding public schools in general from the state.
Right.
So that's a real concern. it is a real genuine concern, I think, about the impact on public schools budgets and towns' budgets.
So does it make sense for the school committee to, at some point, discuss it more formally and take a position that enables us to sign it and have a town school district associated with it, not just Annie McKenzie personally?
I think that's entirely up to the committee. And I wanted to say again that I would, if you don't see my signature as superintendent of schools, it's because we didn't have a chance to talk about something. The implication would be this was something that was fully vetted by the entire committee. Roby has been bringing the work of the CES board to our attention, but you're a separate board. She serves on two boards that have voting rights and other things.
So is this something we'd like to deliberate in January?
I think it would be good to bring it up. And just take sort of a poll of the five of us and determine where we stand, what we would want to advocate for our own community, because we have a stake in that game.
Right.
It's going to be a continuing issue over the next year.
Right. Okay. That sounds good. Okay. Any other school committee reports? I think we've all reported. We got all of our action items completed. Yes. So, evaluation of the meeting.
It's nice to have members of the public.
It was nice to have members of the public. Thank you for discussing more data pertaining to district performance.
Thank you. You might not want to reinforce that all too much, but thank you.
Well, it is a bullet. And we facilitated making sound budget and policy decisions by talking about bus chassis. Yeah. Good. Any feedback from our student representatives? It's thrilling.
I thought it was all really interesting, actually.
Okay.
Great.
Yeah. You're so kind.
That's right.
I've been on school council a lot, so I'm used to talking about administrative issues.
Everything's extremely efficient tonight.
That's true.
We have. They could all be like this. Mm-hmm. Okay, our next meeting date will be January 25th at 5:30, I'm assuming, unless we need exec session. Okay.
At 5:30, did I hear that?
5:30, yep. All right, can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Meeting adjourned.